Good morning, everyone. Ooh, let me try that again. Good morning, everyone. Good morning, you in the back. Good morning, here in the front. Good morning to everyone. I'm Mary Elizabeth Elliott, known by many as Mel. I'm Vice President for Communications, Membership, and IT at CADCA. I just celebrated my 17th anniversary with this organization last week. So this morning I'm filled with gratitude for all of you and for this great work. Now raise your hands if you're like me, an old timer, you've got 17 years in the field. All right. And raise your hand if this is your first mid-year. You've never been here before. Oh my gosh, look around. Let's hear it. Now whether you're a seasoned veteran or you're a new recruit, we've got something here at the mid-year for all of you. This is your professional development. This is your time. You're going to go back to school and become an even stronger leader. Now, there's some additional ways, and I'm going to put my communications hat on. There's additional ways that you can tell your story this week. One is that we're doing a 30 seconds of success video shout out on Wednesday. So you can sign up for that. We want you to get in front of the camera and tell the world about your success in your community. So please go to the CADCA booth and learn about that. The other thing that we can do is we have an opportunity for a Twitter takeover, okay? Raise your hand if you tweet or are on Twitter, if you follow CADCA, great. All right, well, we've been invited by NBC Universal to be part of a Twitter chat tomorrow night. It's at 8 p.m. You can learn more about that at the CADCA booth. And the topic is how to talk to your kids about drugs. And do you think we know how to talk to your kids about drugs? Yes, we do. Now, my honor this morning is to introduce to you the real MC for our session, another Mel, Melanie Piskai. Well, let's hear it from Melanie. But I'm going to tell you about her. Melanie's been actively involved in coalition and prevention work for over 7 years. She currently serves as a member of the Westchester Area Communities That Care, a local community prevention coalition in Exton, Pennsylvania. Since the age of 14, she's been instrumental in the efforts and successes of that coalition. And now she's serving as a youth trainer for CADCA's National Youth Leadership Initiative. All the youth in the house, let's hear it for the NYLI. Let me hear you. Melanie trains and empowers thousands of youth around the country and in the world. Melanie studies sociology and psychology at Ursinus College in Pennsylvania with a goal to amplify her knowledge and experience in community-based prevention. Please welcome my friend, Mel.
Thank you. Good morning. It is now my pleasure to bring to the stage General Arthur T. Dean, who will mark 16 years as chairman and CEO of CADCA on August 31st. Before joining CADCA, he spent 31 years in the U.S. Army. He saw combat in Vietnam and Saudi Arabia. General Dean commanded Army units from company to brigade for 10 years and served in headquarters at the Department of the Army in Washington, D.C. for 10 years. He was a U.S. Army and Republic of Vietnam senior parachutist and an Army Ranger. He possesses numerous awards, with the highest of which being 2 awards of the U.S. Army Distinguished Service Medal. General Dean retired from the Army and joined CADCA that same day. Drug prevention is a true passion for him, and he works every day to represent the coalition field and make CADCA an exceptional organization. Please help me welcome General Arthur T. Dean.
Good morning. Mel, thank you for the very kind introduction. And I want to thank Mel for not telling any of our war stories, because she and I have traveled the globe. We're in Rome together, we're in Vienna together, and lots of places. So she's a great ambassador for our Youth National Leadership Initiative. So thank you, Mel, for being one of our trainers and for the kind introduction. It's really with great gratitude and heartfelt appreciation that so many of you have decided to join us for this great training institute here in Orlando, Florida. So I want to thank all of you for have traveled throughout these great United States, our territories, and from around the world. So may I please thank you for being here and congratulate you for having the foresight and the resources to spend this week with us. So thank you very much. Just a couple shout outs before we get started so I don't forget. All the logistics for this event, and you can imagine there are lots of them, have been led by two of our wonderful staff members back at CATCA. Gwen Breckenridge is our VP for meetings and events, and she pulls all this together, and she's been ably assisted by Christy Gagnon, who's done all of the registrations. So let's give a shout out to Gwen and Christy for their wonderful work, all of the work they've done to support us this week, please. On the program side, the content, all of the courses, all of the objectives, the materials, scheduling everything has been led by none other than CATCA's Vice President for Training and the Director of the Institute, Karima Abdullah, and she's been ably assisted by Christy Miller and Marion. So thank you to them for pulling the content together. Thank you. We have some significant people with us, and I use that word intentionally. I don't use VIP, very important people. I think that's not appropriate for this setting, because all of you are VIPs back in your communities and for the work that you do. But we do have some significant supporters with us today. You will hear more about them. You will hear from some of them this morning. But I wanted to start with two great friends from the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration. And first, I want to say thank you and welcome to my good friend, Kana Anamoto, who is the principal deputy at SAMHSA. Kana, welcome. Thank you. Good to have you here. And I've known this lady for the last 16 years. I met you my very first year at CATCA, and that is Frances Hardin, who is the director of the Center for Substance Abuse Prevention, our federal leader in this field. Fran, thank you for being here. And another lady who is a great supporter of yours as well, because she keeps me straight and prepared to support you. And she's been doing that for many, many years, approaching 30 years. My dear wife, Deborah Dean. Deborah, thank you for being here. And the young lady who is going to speak to you in a little while, as we would say back in the hood, she really rocks. She's our great leader. She's been with CATCA for 20 plus years, and that is our public policy leader extraordinaire, Sue Thaw. Sue, thank you. And you're going to hear from a gentleman who represents our youth movement. And he has grown up to be just a fine young man. He's traveled the world with me as well. He is now in his second year of law school. Many of you heard him yesterday. He was helping us with the introductions. And I'm so proud of Kyrie Smith. Where are you? Kyrie, thank you. So to all of you, again, welcome. We have a wonderful week planned for you. It's all about helping you to become better back in your communities. And when I think of communities, I think of the Drug-Free Communities Program. the program that CATCA was fortunate enough to get Congress to pass back in 1998. It has been ably administered by the Office of National Drug Control Policy for all these years in partnership with the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration. And we have the administrator of the Drug-Free Community Program with us this morning, and that is Helen Hernandez. Helen, thank you for being here. You're going to hear from later this week, the acting director of the Office of National Drug Control Policy will be with us, and that is Michael Bonicelli. So we're excited about Michael being here. In fact, he will be the featured speaker on the DFC town hall meeting that will take place on Wednesday afternoon at 5:15. And all of you are welcome to attend that. It is called the Drug-Free Communities Town Hall Meeting, but you do not have to have a Drug-Free Community grant to attend that meeting, and that's going to be on Wednesday at 5:15, so we're looking forward to that. Also, we are very proud that ONDCP and the acting director will be talking more about that, is one of the primary supporters of our National Youth Leadership Initiative. CATCA has a wonderful board of directors. I think three of them are with us. I'll just tell you quickly, one of them, Curtis Hoagland, is going to be doing a class. You don't want to miss it. He's going to actually repeat it. He is a social media guru from New York City, and Fran Flinner is here. She is the state leader in Arkansas, appointed by the governor, and we have Doug Hughes, who some of you heard yesterday, from the great city of Miami. Three of our board members are with us, and we're excited to have such wonderful members. It's all about equipping you to handle local drug issues. It's all about building capacity in you to solve your drug challenges. I like to say when I travel and talk to others that CATCA doesn't go into a community to solve its substance abuse problems. Our goal is to build the capacity and skills and capabilities into you so you can solve your local substance abuse problems. And all of those problems are unique for each community. And our goal this week is to help you do that. In the process of doing that, we are trying to take advantage of social media. We are launching a lot of online courses. We want you to help us participate in our Medicine Abuse Prevention Month in October. It's going to be the 18th one that we're going to do. And tied into that, we're going to be launching a brand new online Medicine Abuse Prevention Toolkit this week here at the mid-year. So please find out more about that at the CATCA's booth. We are excited about that campaign and want you to be a part of it. Please do that. So whether you are challenged by underage drinking, whether you're facing discouragement associated with the misuse and abuse of over-the-counter medicine and prescription medicines, whether it's the issues that we all face related to marijuana or synthetics or tobacco, or all of the illicit drugs, we want to help you with those. That's our intent. We understand that our training has to be current. It has to be in a manner that you and your members back in your communities can benefit from. And that's why we are moving to the social media to help us do that. We have something going on here called Join the Click. There will be information available for you to see that, and I think there may be a slide up that talks about that, so please take advantage of that. I want to shift now and talk a little bit about the wonderful work that we're doing around the globe. We're so fortunate to be working now in 19 countries. We've been in 24, currently in 19, training in 7 languages, going to 8 languages, but we want to welcome our good friends from 16 countries that have traveled far and near to be with us from around the globe. And you can see from the countries that are represented here. So if you would help me, let's give a warm CATCO welcome to our international friends. Please do that. We are really working very diligently in the tobacco space, in addition to all the other things that I've mentioned to you. After this conference ends on Thursday, we're going to spend a whole day Friday working and talking and learning about geographic health equity issues as it relates to tobacco and cancer. We're doing that work with a grant from the Centers for Disease Control out of Atlanta, CDC. We're excited about that work. We know many of you face tobacco issues back in your communities, and we want to do all we can do to help you with that issue. Now, I'd like to just spend a few minutes talking to you, if I can, about the things that are going on in our movement and why we're working so hard to help you. You know, we were fortunate enough to arrange for the SMART approaches to marijuana, which is called SAM, to come in a day early to spend a whole day, Saturday evening and Sunday, talking about the issues as it relates to marijuana and what you can do back in your communities to help inform and educate the citizens so that they can make right and good, wholesome decisions. So we are very supportive of SAM's work. We will continue to do that, and I simply want to make sure that everybody fully understands that we are, in fact, supportive of that great work, and we'll continue to do that. So let's applaud them. Thank you. We want you to stay connected with us. I hope all of you and all of the members of your community are signed up for Coalition Online. It's free. It comes out every Thursday. It's the latest information in the field. If you are not signed up, please do that. And also make sure that all the volunteers in your community are signed up as well. As Mel said earlier, please help us by liking us on Facebook, LinkedIn, tweet with us as well, blog with us. It's important that we do all of that to show the power of this movement. It is critical that we do that, and I want you to help us do that. We got something special coming up in Washington in February. I want to remind you, many of you will know this, but when we have our National Leadership Conference back in Washington at the Gaylord in February, it will be CATCA's 25th National Leadership Conference. So congratulations to you, our 25th. We've already have a theme. It's in your booklet, and the theme is Mission Impossible, Agents of Change. That's what the theme is going to be. It's going to be a grand celebration, lots of special events and activities, to include for you ladies a 25th anniversary gala. So we are going to dress up and have some fun. So I look forward to that. You know, we are in the great state of Florida. We're in Orlando. And you can't, I mean, you can look out of your windows depending on the side of the hotel you're in, and you can see Disney. But I want to quote from the great Walt Disney, because I think this is a very applicable quote for our movement. And what he said was, "If you can dream it, you can do it." And that really is applicable for us. If we can dream it, we can do it. If we can dream about those drug-free, safe, healthy communities, if we can dream about young Americans that are not impacted by substance abuse in its all facets, if we can dream about the Kyrie and Mel young leaders growing up in very tough circumstances and becoming great leaders in this country,
then we can make that happen. So let's dream it so we can make it happen. And I know we can, and I'm excited about that as well. Thank you very much. So, are you excited and ready for a great week? It's going to be, as they say, over in the Magic Kingdom, it's going to be a roller coaster ride. It's going to have some ups and downs, but in the end, you're going to feel exhilarated. You're going to be ready to go back into those communities and continue your great work. And that's really what it's all about. So enjoy the ride. Grab a few friends, hang on to them, take advantage of all the courses that have been designed for you. And if you get a chance to say hi to the 400 youth that are here for the National Leadership Conference, please do that, please. I want to conclude by showing you a quick video, because we have some other speakers that I want you to hear from. And please do me a favor by allowing them to speak to you. We have plenty of time to get to the courses. And you know what? No course will start without you. So don't worry about it, okay? We're going to be just fine. But our good friends in Mexico recently was hosting an event back in June around these issues. And many countries have adopted our strategy to be the main strategy to help them with substance abuse. Brazil has done that, Mexico has done that, and many other countries as well. So our good friends in Mexico took one of our videos and used it, and they actually put subtitles in it in Spanish as well. So rather than showing you the American version of this video, I decided to show you the one that was done by our friends in Mexico, and it has Spanish in it on the subtitles. So would you run the video, please, and have a great, great week.
I am chaperoning his field trip.
I am staying in school.
I am walking her down the aisle.
I am a positive influence.
I am a leader.
Because I am Katka.
I am Katka.
We are Katka.
We all are Katka, and it shows. This is no easy job. This is real. This is powerful. This is what happens when every one of us pours every bit of us into making a difference for one person, one community, one nation. One world. You are CADCA, and we move with you. Consider that just over 20 years ago, CADCA was a grassroots effort with 300 coalitions. Today, we make up a 5,000 coalition family, and it's our collective efforts that better lives. As individuals, we are bold, smart, and influential. As coalitions, we are visible, vocal, and valuable. And as an organization, we are poised to unify, to move a nation, to create and maintain safe, healthy, drug-free communities for us all. In our movement. We are CADCA.
That's a great video. So it is my honor to bring up our next speaker. Kana Inamoto was appointed in August 2011 as the Principal Deputy Administrator for the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration, or SAMHSA, at the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. In this capacity, Ms. Inamoto serves as Principal Advisor to the Administrator on policies and programmatic activities. Ms. Inamoto brings 23 years of experience in the behavioral health field, 15 of which have been in federal service at SAMHSA. She previously served as the principal senior advisor to three SAMHSA administrators and as the acting deputy administrator. She began her tenure at SAMHSA in 1998 as a presidential management fellow and special assistant to the director of Center for Mental Health Services. Ms. Inamoto received her bachelor's degree in psychology and master's degree in clinical psychology from the University of California, Los Angeles, and is a 2011 graduate of Harvard University's Kennedy School of Government, Senior Managers in Government Program. She has received numerous awards in recognition of her work. Please give a warm welcome to Kana Inamoto.
Good morning. Good morning. Thank you, Mel. And thank you, General Dean. I used to think General was his first name. But it's not. And for those of you, many of you probably already know better than I did, but general is a title, is a rank of an officer that means that he is one of the best leaders in this nation. And the substance abuse prevention community is so lucky to have him. I would follow you anywhere, General Dean. Thank you so much. Welcome to the 2014 Mid-Year Training Institute. SAMHSA is so pleased to continue its partnership with CADCA at this intensive training opportunity. I want to acknowledge Helen Hernandez from the Office of National Drug Control Prevent Policy and our wonderful administrator for the DFC program, a program that SAMHSA administers on behalf of ONDCP. I also want to acknowledge Fran Harding, our really, really amazing director for the Center for Substance Abuse Prevention at SAMHSA. I'd also like to acknowledge the number of SAMHSA staff who are here today. I've seen you all running around the hotel because they are, I understand this is, CADCA's event is a wonderful training opportunity. Part of that and how SAMHSA contributes is by bringing our prevention experts to the table so they can help you learn more about what we do, about the Drug-Free Communities Program, about our Strategic Prevention Framework Program, and the other things that we have to offer at SAMHSA. So will the SAMHSA staff please stand up? All right. So they are here. Please look for them. I also bring you greetings from Administrator Pam Hyde. She was appointed by the President in 2009. She's unable to be here today, and so I'm here on her behalf. And I am a first-time attendee, like many of you. You may have also heard that we have at the Department of Health and Human Services a new secretary. Sylvia Matthews Burwell, Secretary Sylvia Matthews Burwell, was sworn in as the 22nd Secretary of the Department for Health and Human Services on June 9th, 2014. And we at SAMHSA are so pleased to have her. She's from West Virginia originally. She's very familiar with the issues of addiction and of the need for substance abuse prevention. She feels these matters very close to her heart. And she is a results-driven manager. She is already asking us, what are you doing to ensure that every American has access to the building blocks of a healthy and productive life? What are you trying to achieve for this country? And how are we going to get there? And how are we going to get there faster? She has called for us to operate under three guiding principles: to deliver results on a wide range of complex issues, to strengthen the relationships that drive progress, and to build strong teams with the talent and focus needed to deliver impact for the American people. And I know that that is something that in the communities where you live, that is what you are doing. And so it is our job to help support you because you are contributing to that mission that we are trying to achieve on behalf of the President, on behalf of the Secretary, and on behalf of the American people. Secretary Burwell's focus on results and the impact of our federal investments in health programming highlights the importance of data. We know the work of coalitions is critical to improving public health, and SAMHSA understands the challenges you have in demonstrating the cause and effect of environmental strategies to reduce substance abuse. We know that it works, but we have to be able to tell that story to other people. And so while demonstrating outcomes is not an easy task, it is critical to ensure that prevention showcases its accomplishments with data. And on behalf of SAMHSA, I thank you for your dedication to substance abuse prevention in your communities. The power of coalitions is that local people solve local problems best, and people support what they help to create. So the longevity and the diversity of your coalitions is evidence of the power of the movement. We have seen over the years that community coalitions are fundamental to achieving reductions in the rates of alcohol, tobacco, and marijuana use among their youth. And this event is an ideal opportunity for you to share ideas and to learn more about making the most of your efforts. I saw so many of you that, like me, are first-time attendees at the mid-year. And this is a great opportunity for you to understand how are those more seasoned coalitions getting the results that you want for your community. Collectively, your efforts at the community level do reflect SAMHSA's vision of a nation that understands and acts on the knowledge that behavioral health, that includes mental health and substance abuse, behavioral health is essential to health. Prevention works, you all know that. Treatment is effective, and people recover. As leaders in community-based prevention, SAMHSA is interested in how your coalitions and your technology, your power, your relationships, how can they work across mental health, substance abuse, and primary care? And how does all of that work then turn into positive outcomes in substance abuse prevention? We are extending prevention's reach, and that includes involving the gap between the public health approach, which focuses on population-based health issues, and clinical medicine that focuses on individual health issues. How many here have heard about the Affordable Care Act? Oh, come on, Obamacare. How many people have heard of Obamacare? All right, now you see some hands. Well, within Obamacare, there is a tremendous focus on prevention. Tremendous focus on prevention, but that tends to be clinical preventive services. So those things that doctors and nurses and PAs that they do in their settings with individuals or with families, and not so much what happens with communities. There's some funding there that can be supportive of communities, and SAMHSA is trying to work with the department overall to make that bridge between what we do in doctors' offices and what we do in our communities and make sure that we are informing the health sector of what really works in prevention, because that is what we want to do. Our emphasis on behavioral health recognizes the strong link between mental health and substance abuse, because about half of all people with a serious mental illness will develop a substance use disorder at some point in their lifetimes. And we know that 75% of mental illnesses emerge before the age of 24, so about half before the age of 14 and three quarters by the age of 24. And so that coincides with the age group that we're also really concerned about for substance abuse. So for us, we are really trying to look at these problems together because we care that about people's health overall as well as their behavioral health. And we know that if you have a behavioral health condition, you have worse outcomes. So people actually, if you have breast cancer and depression, you actually have a poorer prognosis than if you just have breast cancer alone. If you have diabetes and an uncontrolled alcohol problem, you have a worse prognosis than if you have just diabetes alone. And if you try to treat that person, it'll cost twice as much to treat the person with diabetes who's using alcohol than the person who has diabetes and is not using alcohol. And that person is more likely to have poor health outcomes. So what you do is important, not just for the immediate substance abuse prevention, because that by itself has a ripple effect across people's lives, and it is really, really fundamental to the health of our nation. We understand that alcohol continues to be the most widely used substance of abuse among America's youth and young adults. How many of your coalitions are focused on underage drinking? Okay, I don't have my glasses on actually, but I think that's probably most of you. I saw a lot of movement. Luckily, I'm not driving. Community action, together with state and federal initiatives, continues to decrease underage drinking and its consequences, but still far too many young people die every year in alcohol-related injuries. And rates of current binge and heavy drinking among adolescents, however, have fallen to record lows, and we hope to make a dent in this problem for this country. And although drinking levels are lower at younger ages, patterns of consumption across the age spectrum pose significant threats to health and well-being. Particularly troubling is the closing of the gap that young women and young men are starting to follow patterns that are more similar to each other. And it used to be much higher for the boys, but it isn't that way anymore. And so, you know, to the degree we are looking at gender-specific approaches, what are the messages that we need to be sending to those young women that could be making a difference in their behaviors? Another issue that SAMHSA is really concerned about is suicide. And I've talked to some of you and the work that you're doing in your coalitions, and while you're focused on substance abuse prevention, that's obviously why you're here today, some of you are doing work on suicide, as well as bullying and other really important issues that the young people in your communities are struggling with. We know that suicidal behavior rises in adolescence, and it's a period when substance abuse is also reaching a peak and when mental illnesses are first starting to appear. So more than a third of those people who die by suicide have a blood alcohol level over the legal limit. So substance abuse and suicide are intrinsically related. Concern about suicide and the factors that drive it speaks to the need to build partnerships with our colleagues working on suicide prevention so that you can bring your expertise to bear on what they are trying to do. Because without you, they won't be successful. Another one of the important challenges that SAMHSA is really facing together with you, together with the nation, is the ongoing need to educate parents who may not be aware that the significant rates of misuse of narcotic pain medicine by children and teens is increasing. In 2011, more than 4,500 young people per day abused a prescription drug for the first time. So 4,500 people a day are starting to abuse prescription drugs. And like many adults, young people may have the false sense of security that if a doctor's prescribed it, it's safe, but you know better. Just because it's legal does not mean it's safe. That brings us to the marijuana issue. The marijuana issue has changed dramatically over the last few years. Some of you may be very aware of that in your own states. But we need to keep marijuana use on prevention's radar screen. This is, I think Sue Thaw has used this statistic a time or 20. The percentage of adolescents who saw great risk from smoking marijuana once or twice a week began to slide in 2007, where it was 54.6%, to well under half of youth in 2012, only 43.6%, the lowest rate in many years. So young people are now starting to think, well, if it's legal, it must not be dangerous. And we know, and the director, Nora Volkow, from the National Institute of Drug Abuse, will show you the PET scan slides that prove that using marijuana in adolescence fundamentally changes the brain in not good ways. It damages the brain. And it's important to make sure that underage people are not using marijuana and that older people are not getting addicted to marijuana. Another growing challenge is the large number of new synthetic drugs. This is very hard to keep up with. These drugs are being abused primarily by young people, and they're unregulated substances chemically designed to mimic the effects of existing drugs. So synthetic drugs like spice, which is designed to mimic marijuana or to be a marijuana substitute, they may be even more dangerous than the real thing. And another class of substances like bath salts appear to be alternatives to cocaine, amphetamine, and ecstasy. They can also have really, really detrimental effects on people's brains and people's behaviors. Synthetic drugs are easy to get and have severe effects, and new ones are appearing every day. It's something that all of us need to be vigilant on, and I thank you for your efforts in this area. In 2011, SAMHSA released its first strategic plan under Administrator Hyde. It's called Leading Change, a plan for SAMHSA's roles and actions. In this plan, we had 8 strategic initiatives. The prevention of mental illness and substance abuse was the number one strategic initiative. It is something that our administrator has emphasized over and over again. We cannot treat our way out of the nation's problems around substance abuse and mental health. We must emphasize prevention. So in addition to trauma and justice, recovery support, health information technology, health reform, data and communications, we have harnessed the energy of the whole of SAMHSA on our prevention efforts. And in Leading Change 2.0, Advancing Behavioral Health of the Nation for 2015 to 2018, we are outlining 6 new strategic initiatives. And the number one strategic initiative is still prevention of mental illness and substance abuse. So we hope that all of you, when that comes out, will go online. We're going to put it out for public comment. And you can vote and click and comment on what we're doing. We're kind of trying to be like CAGCA, and we have the click or whatever this says. Yes, we're in the click. But yes, we want to know what you think about the strategic initiatives, about our goals, and what we're putting forward. And if there are suggestions that you have, you can participate in the online conversation about our strategic plan. We actually do read them all, and we classify them and sort them, and we make changes based on them. For the first time in many years, SAMHSA will be adding a strategic initiative on workforce. The behavioral health workforce, and that's some of what you're doing here. When we're talking about the behavioral health workforce, we're not talking just about the clinicians and the docs and the nurses and the psychologists, but we're also talking about the prevention specialists. We need more preventionists, and we need more preventionists that work in all kinds of different settings, because where you are is great, schools are great, communities are great, but we need preventionists in hospitals who know, who can make those linkages to the efforts that are going on in communities. We need preventionists in other settings because it's not just about the clinical preventive service, it's about the whole community understanding how to approach prevention in a scientific way. I want to talk to you a little bit about what we have on the table in front of Congress. The President put forward his budget for 2015, and I know Sue's going to give you all the tools and all the inside stuff about how to actually make those things happen, what is on CADCA's agenda. But I want to talk to you a little bit about where SAMHSA's coming from. We are targeting resources to evidence-based prevention and treatment interventions. We're working to integrate HIV in the continuum of care. Did you know that 30% of people with HIV are not getting appropriate clinical services? So people with HIV are not going out, are going without their HIV care. It's a phenomenal number of people when we know that this is a condition that we can manage so well. And many of these people with HIV are in our systems. They're getting drug treatment. They're getting services for their mental illness. And we're going to try to bring those HIV services into the behavioral health setting. And we're trying to decrease negative attitudes towards seeking help for mental health and substance abuse problems, and also just decrease negative attitudes about the work that we do. And there might be some people who would say, well, why are you doing substance abuse prevention? Isn't that just people's personal decision, or isn't that just if people have a weak character, then they'll do that, but if they know what's right, they won't do that? And people really don't understand the challenges and the science that's behind the work that we're all doing. And so we need to do, we need to talk about our country and changing social norms to understand that these are problems that have major social and health and economic impacts in our communities. And so they are worth preventing. They're worth treating, and they're worth supporting people who are in recovery, because if we don't do that, we're going to face incredible economic and social impacts. Specifically, one of our requests is $10 million for what we so fondly call SPIFRX, because we like acronyms. But that's our strategic prevention framework, and within that, we're going to have $10 million to focus on prescription drugs and opioids. And that's $4 million is for state strategic planning, for prescription drug monitoring program data and interfacing that with electronic health records, evidence-based programs, and or environmental strategies. $4 million will be for planning grants to 20 states to build their capacity, also to focus on preventing opioid overdoses. That's a big issue. We now have more opioid we have more drug overdoses than car accidents, or people dying from drug overdose than car accidents, and that's a huge tragedy, as well as funding, supporting some more evaluations so that we can get that important data to show that what we're trying to do is working. We also have a very small amount of money, but I think it's important. It's something that I really care about. It's $3 million for behavioral health coalitions. So we're braiding mental health funding and substance abuse funding because we want drug-free communities, we want community coalitions to come in and bring the expertise that you have and bring it to bear with some of our other grant programs. So if we're doing something about early childhood and mental health, rather than them bring together a steering committee and 20 different organizations and sectors, wouldn't it be great if a drug-free community could partner with them and say, hey, we also care about early childhood. We also care about maternal health and early childhood mental health. And we have a set of partners who can show you how we use data, how we access evidence-based practices, how we influence environmental strategies to assist with the problem that you're trying to do. And so those behavioral health coalitions are about leveraging the knowledge and the power that coalitions have to advance some of our other priority issues, because I think you have a lot to bring to bear to that. Many of you, I'm sure, are aware of the really unfortunate events that happened in Newtown, Connecticut, as well as reaching back, Columbine, Jonesboro, Colorado. It's happened so many times that we have these unfortunate events of school violence. And SAMHSA has been in this space for over a dozen years, and we've given out $2 billion worth of grants to try to improve, to create safe schools and healthy students. In 2014, for the first time, we got Project AWARE, the president proposed as part of his overall national plan to reduce gun violence and improve access to mental health services. And we have two components of that. One are the Project AWARE state grants, where we are working with states who will in turn work with communities to advance a safe schools, healthy students model statewide, which is a partnership between schools, law enforcement, other community organizations to make sure that we are finding and we are preventing youth violence, we're preventing bullying, and that we're identifying young people who may be having problems with their mental health and getting them to services as soon as we can. Also preventing substance abuse in the schools and around with the young people. We also have $15 million for Mental Health First Aid. And that is to local educational agencies to work with their communities and train people so that they understand what do mental illnesses and substance use disorders really look like, and what might you do if you meet someone that you think is experiencing a problem. So it's not to train people to become clinicians, but it's to be comfortable so that if you see someone who really seems to have a problem, what are a couple of phrases that you could use, and how could you enter into that conversation with that person so that you might be able to say, hey, I think you might need some help. And we are trying to support increasing awareness of mental health and substance abuse issues to connect young people with services and with their families, with the supports that they need. We have $20 million for Healthy Transitions, which is focusing on young people ages 16 to 25, because we know that's the age when serious mental illnesses often start to emerge. In closing, I think you all are familiar. People say people don't like to be changed. People aren't afraid of change. They don't like to be change. Right? They like to be part of the change. And I think you understand that prevention, that's what it's about. It's about change. And you have coalitions that are working to change social norms, coalitions that are looking to create community-level change, and coalitions creating population-level change. And we are so grateful for that. A note of caution. I know I talked about some specific drugs. We don't want you to become too focused on specific drugs, because what you know and the power that you have, it can be used across the different drugs that your communities are facing. But please keep your sights on achieving our shared goal to prevent mental and substance use disorders and related problems in our communities. Because you know your communities, you know how to bring people together, you know how to use the latest prevention science, and you know how to tell your prevention story. Secretary Burwell is fond of an African proverb that says, if you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. When it comes to protecting the health and the well-being of our nation's young people, we at SAMHSA look forward to going together with you to achieve all that we can for this country. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much once again. SAMHSA's doing a lot of good work. The next speaker that I have the honor to introduce is one of the most wonderful ladies that I've gotten to travel with over the years. Sue Thaw is a public policy consultant representing the Community Anti-Drug Coalition of America. She is nationally recognized for her advocacy and legislative accomplishments on behalf of the substance abuse prevention field. She has an extensive background in public policy and has held high positions in federal, state, and local levels. She was a budget examiner in the Executive Office of the President for over 10 years. She has an undergraduate degree from Cornell University in Human Development and Family Studies and a master's degree from Rutgers University in City and Regional Planning. Sue was a driving force behind the passage and full funding of the Drug-Free Communities Act and has helped to save and enhance the funding for the Safe and Drug-Free Schools and Communities Act. Programs funded through the Centers of Substance Abuse Prevention and Treatment in Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services. She is highly respected as an expert on demand reduction issues by members of Congress and staff on both sides of the aisle on Capitol Hill. Please help me give a warm welcome to Sue Thaw.
Katka. All right. So I want to start by saying it's a quote from John Stuart Mill from the 1800s. One person with a belief is equal to a force of 99 who have only interests. We are not an interest group. We are a movement that is mission driven. We have data. And we believe that keeping kids alcohol, tobacco, and drug-free is what we need to work tirelessly to do. We are amazing professionals, and we are part of a movement all working together. Yes? Okay. So we're a movement with a mission, and our power derives from the following formula that has really served us for the past 20 years. And I want to take 1 second to explain how this works. So we at CATCA have some real public policy expertise. We track legislation, we write it, we influence it. We really do weigh in on all of the policy discussions in Washington, D.C., both with Congress and with our great friends from SAMHSA and ONDCP and CDC and others. And thank you, everybody that's here. Kana, fantastic job. Thank you, Fran. Thank you, Helen, all of you. But we're all great friends. We work really closely together. But that's not enough. A plus something has to equal something. It can't just be CATCA alone. So it's CATCA plus CATCA's network, which is you, our adult and youth leaders who have passion and are intelligent and the hardest workers I've ever met. It's you working with us. Yep. And responding to our legislative alerts and actually building relationships with all of your elected officials because you opened the door for me and my team, okay? So what have we accomplished working together? Okay. See if I can push the right button here. Okay, so that formula has actually resulted since 1994, and this is really an amazing number, in the restoration of cuts to substance abuse prevention and or funding increases above a base of almost $3 billion with a B. Amazing. Right, it's amazing. And this only accounts for appropriation successes that are CATCA-driven. This doesn't include the fact that we work and mobilize you every year to save the money for the Substance Abuse Prevention and Treatment Block Grant. We let NASADAD have that on their balance sheet. This is only money we've saved for the substance abuse prevention field over 20 years. And believe me, we wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for our formula, you and us working together. And I want to take 1 second to talk about how many of you were with us when we were fighting to save the funding for the Safe and Drug-Free Schools and Communities program. Okay, not a lot of you, but I'm going to take 1 second to say, for 15 years, this program was vulnerable. And every year for 15 years, we saved this program. About two-thirds of that $3 billion almost dollars is money that we saved for safe and drug-free schools and communities. Why does that matter? Because CATCA didn't get anything from this program. We believe in substance abuse prevention across the board. We will fight for every single program that funds our field. Okay, we love coalitions, they're our base, but whoever isn't a coalition and does substance abuse prevention funding, we are fighting for you. So let me explain how the formulas work for the Drug-Free Communities program. CATCA took the idea for this program to Capitol Hill. Okay, from the very beginning, we were working to convince people that not only coalitions worked, but we really needed them funding. However, the champions that took this program and got it funded were all people that we got from you, our members, who had relationships with their members of Congress. Okay, and as those people changed, we needed to find new champions for the Drug-Free Communities program. I know Donna Foisey is here, and I have to say, she and Lee Rush from Bucks County, Pennsylvania, found us our new Republican champion in the House, Mike Fitzpatrick. This is how this happens. They had a relationship with him, they brought me in, they brought their data in, and between CATCA, Donna and Lee, equaled a new champion for Drug-Free Communities. That is how this works. Kana talked about being data-driven. Oh my God, are we data-driven? We have suitcases full of one-pagers that show reductions from a baseline in 30-day alcohol, tobacco, drug use, synthetic marijuana use, prescription drug abuse. We have it, we need it, and we use it. This is just an example. So there's a senator who's ranking member for deciding how much money the Drug-Free Communities program gets. We were able to bring this chart to him, which is of a coalition in Nebraska that's actually his, in his state, and show them this incredible decrease in 30-day marijuana use. We were able to connect this program directly to you guys in his state, the Wisner Nebraska Healthy Communities Initiative, and you know what? We got $92 million in the Senate for Drug-Free Communities in no small part because we had charts like this to share with every single appropriator on the Senate Financial Services Appropriations Committee. Thank you. Again, you have the data. We bring it to the Hill. Now look at this. Carter, Kentucky. Prescription drug use, it's an epidemic all over, but it's really horrible in Kentucky. Look at these outcomes from 2004 to 2012. They went from 12th grade 30-day use going from 12% to 2%. Is that amazing? It's amazing. And look what happened because of that. Chairman Rogers, chairman of the full House Appropriations Committee, announced at the markup of their financial services bill that he actually increased the Drug-Free Communities program from the administration's request of 85.7 million to $95 million. That's a $10 million increase. And I don't know if you can see what he said, but basically, this is a successful program. It works. We know it works. We've seen an uptick in the abuse of heroin, and these community coalitions are more important than any time in the past. Why did he think that? Because he saw your data. It matters. We bring the data in, but we can't bring it in unless you get it to us. Okay, the formula also works for the STOP Act. How many of you know about the Sober Truth on Preventing Underage Drinking or our grantees? This is a really important program because these are enhancement grants to existing and former drug-free communities grantees to get a little bit of money to do a lot on underage drinking. Now, at the forum, we said to you, this needs to be reauthorized, and we need your help to get more members on. And I'm really pleased to tell you that since the forum, we have 23 new co-sponsors of this because of your work, 9 of whom are Republicans, okay? Amazing. Now, also because of the forum and the Hill visits, we had about 100 people who went up to Capitol Hill from New York State, and they asked Senator Schumer if he would be the Democratic sponsor in the Senate. We didn't have any Senate sponsors, and you know what? Last week he said yes, he was going to do it. Thank you, New York. Okay, and we also need a Republican champion. So is Deborah Williams from Alaska in the House? Well, we need to really thank Deborah. Look at her outcomes on 30-day alcohol use among 9th to 12th graders in Alaska. We shared this with Senator Murkowski, and we're waiting to see if she's going to come on. But again, this is the formula. It's CATCA plus you and your data and our being able to share it that is what really, really works here. Okay, next. So, we also use this formula to keep substance abuse prevention and coalitions in front of key policymakers. As I said, we're at the table in Washington at every meeting, every briefing that has anything to do with alcohol, tobacco, and drug prevention, treatment, and recovery. And we work on all issues, everything from marijuana to synthetic drugs to prescription drugs to synthetics, and we bring you along to every meeting in the room with us to praise what you do, to promote what you do, and to share your outcomes. So, did I goof again? Okay, yes. The White House actually had a summit on the link between education and decreased drug use. We actually worked to help come up with the idea for this, and we suggested that one of our coalition members, Kat Allen from Franklin County, Massachusetts, be a presenter. And this is a very hard slide to read, but what she was able to show was that as her coalition decreased alcohol, tobacco, and drug use, they also decreased poor school bonding, they decreased poor academic achievements, and they increased high school graduation rates. Folks, that's amazing. Okay, the Addiction Treatment and Recovery Caucus, that doesn't include the words prevention, does it? But they decided they needed to do a prevention briefing. And guess what? They asked us for ideas for speakers. And two of the four speakers are CATCA members who had incredible outcomes. One is Ellen Morehouse, who not only spoke about the drug-free community program, she also gets money from the 20% set aside in the prevention and treatment block grant. And the other one was Margaret Brennan. Now this one's amazing. Congressman Tonka, her congressman, knew her personally. So he invited her to speak, and then she, Ellen, and I figured out how they were each going to do the presentations. But anytime there's an opportunity to highlight your work and what you do, we open the door, bring you in, and you take over and do it. Unbelievable. Okay. The formula also works to tie coalition expertise to all emerging alcohol and drug issues. And here's just an example, again, of a prescription drug outcome from the Barrington Prevention Coalition in Barrington, Rhode Island, where they, in fact, decreased the rate at 61% among 12th graders from 2009 to 2011. So how do we use this data? Is everybody in Washington worried about prescription, drug abuse, overdoses, moving to heroin? Yeah, gigantic issue. And there are a lot of people who are working on legislation. What I can tell you is we're in every one of those meetings with a group from our field. We're the prevention people through the recovery support people. And what we're pushing is to get authorization for a new coalition enhancement grant based on the STOP Act model, where current and past drug-free communities grantees can get supplements of up to $75,000 to deal with their community's prescription drug issues with real scale and scope. What do you think? Does it sound good? Okay, but we're gonna need your help. But anyway, we're working really, really hard on that. Okay, Connor mentioned synthetic drugs. The first hearing ever held on synthetic drugs that Senator Feinstein and Senator Grassley did in the Drug Caucus, we had Eric O'Leary from California, from the North Coastal Prevention Coalition, talking about how they found out that this was a problem and what needed to be done about it and how coalitions can help. Again, emerging drug issue, we're right there. Okay, but the formula only works if you guys really respond to CATCA's alerts and requests for help. And all I want to say is, it takes 2 minutes to use our CAPWIS system. 2 minutes. We need you. If you did 10 a year, it would be $8 worth of your time. If you decide that you, you know, can't do it from work, do it from home. This is how it works. And I want to end with just a quote from Winston Churchill. Success is not final. Failure is not fatal. It's the courage to continue that counts. And really, it's up to all of us. CATCA plus you guys equal money and great policies for our nation, for our communities, and for our youth. Thank you. You guys are amazing. Please help us continue to power the movement.
Born and raised in Hartford, Connecticut, Kyrie Smith defied the norm. Kyrie led thousands of local youth in his local organization, Stump the Violence Youth Leadership Initiative. He showed them how to conduct research and community assessments and translated them to help secure $1.5 million in grants. In the summer of 2012, Kyrie worked as a White House intern for the Obama administration in the Office of National Drug Control Policy. He has spoken in over 40 states and 4 countries across 3 continents. He was recently appointed by the Secretary of Health and Human Services to serve on the National Advisory Council for the Center of Substance Abuse Prevention. Today, as a lead youth trainer for the NYLI, he leads a team of powerful young trainers. They utilize prevention science and multimedia modalities to inspire over 1,000 youth per year in leadership, prevention, and intervention. After graduating Hampton University with honors, earning a bachelor's degree in sociology, Kyrie is in his second year of law school at the Catholic University of America, Columbus School of Law, at the top of his class. Please help me welcome Mr. Kyrie Smith.
Good morning. Thank you, Mel. That was nice of you. As always, I'd like to start by thanking you, General Dean, and Ms. Karima Abdullah for all you both do for the world. Let's give them a round of applause, please. I'm gonna sit this here, if that's okay. But is that better? But I have to admit that when I heard the theme or the slogan for this year's mid-year, I had a somewhat cynical thought occur to me. The power of the movement, it made me wonder if there really is a such thing as a movement anymore. And we live in this information age where we know about everything instantly. So there's no shortage of outrage. There's always something to be outraged about. Kidnapped Nigerian girls, outrage. We talked about Newtown, outrage. Colorado, Trayvon Martin, the neglect of Chicago, outrageous. LeBron James leaving the Miami Heat. I mean, outrageous. And we express our dissatisfaction in these meticulously crafted, eloquently painted Facebook statuses and impressively efficient Twitter rants. And then this goes on for about 2, maybe 3 weeks. And then after that, nothing. Silence. I've deemed these stints the temporary movement, which is completely oxymoronic, I know. But you have to admit that gone are the days of galvanizing the masses via soaring speeches or televised sit-ins or protests or decade-long shared sentiments that completely shift a culture. Things just look different now. So it's a reasonable question, is there a such thing as a movement anymore? And if we're being honest with ourselves, between just me and the 2,000 of you, I think the answer is absolutely. Absolutely. So, okay, Kyrie, if there is a such thing as a movement, as you say, then I think the next logical question is, well, where is the power of this movement? And I would say the answer to that question is as simple as it is elegant and beautiful. The power of the movement is in the neglected snooze button of your alarm clock. It's in the everyday. It's in the pen of every politician on our side in this fight. It's in the maturity of every young person who opts not to make fun of someone with addiction and therefore fighting the stigma. It's in the 40,000 families per year to lose someone to the drug problem. It's in our everyday. It's in the pen of every legislator with the integrity and the fortitude to stand on morality rather than acquiescing to the latest trend. That's where the power is. It's not that we can't see the power because it's not there or because it's too small. We can't see it because it's become too big. It has become ingrained in our everyday. We can't see the power of the movement in the same way that we can't see the universe, but we can see the stars. When's the last time you really, really appreciated the stars? Like stood under their marvelousness and just marveled at their brilliance. The stars burn for us every single night without fail. So dedicated that we've lost our ability to appreciate what they do every day. Well, we have the unique opportunity to be in a room full of 2,000 stars, and I want you to give yourself some appreciation right now. I have a fascination with the concept of exponential growth, the idea that you can roll a snowball down the hill, and not only does the snowball gain mass from collecting snow, but the rate at which it gains mass increases as well. It's the idea that you can be passionate about a thing, and you can share that passion with someone, and then it doesn't just double, it triples or quadruples or quintuples, because now, not only do they have the passion, you still have it, and the passion that you started with has grown because you're so excited and encouraged that someone else shares your passion. Now think about that phenomena happening among 2,000 people, and then multiply that by 4 or 5 days. Now, I'm no mathematician, which is why I went to law school, but that's a lot of power. That is a lot of power, but the fear is that negativity spreads as well, as illustrated by the drug problem we're here to face. But I am encouraged by the fact that the cruelty of our shared human condition is interrupted by your compassion and your sacrifice. I said I am encouraged by the fact that that cruelty of our shared human condition is interrupted daily by your compassion and your sacrifice. That's power. That is power. You know, I, as you heard, I recently survived my first year of law school, and it taught me a few things. Thank you. It taught me a few things. The first thing it taught me was that there is an actual point in time where your brain will come out of your head, call you crazy, and refuse to read another word. Like, that's an actual real thing that happens to people in the world, in life. But the other thing I learned is the difference between cramming, a thing that I call montaging, and then another thing that I call goal integration. So we all know what cramming is, right? It's that thing you do in undergrad the night before a test because going to the party and getting a B, B minus doesn't really seem like such a bad deal. That's cramming. That's one end of the spectrum. And then we have in the middle what I call montaging. This is when you give yourself a little bit more time, but you really go hard preparing for the test or whatever it is that you're preparing for. It's the thing that Rocky does right before the fight, or the montage that happens in every fight movie that you've ever seen. You montage. And then the last thing is goal integration. This is where you don't wait, right? This is where you spread all of your preparatory actions and things that you need to do to accomplish your goal across the period of time from right now till the day that that goal needs to be accomplished. So all the minute little actions get spread across that time. This less dazzling, less dramatic, less fiery way is by far the most powerful way to do anything. Now, I genuinely can tell you that I never understood the story of the tortoise and the hare until law school. And that's what goal integration is about. That's what you do every single day. And that's why you are so powerful and why you are so necessary. We all want to do something. We all want to leave a footprint on the world. We want to impress upon the shared consciousness of the world something good. And I gauge my own progress in this regard by the amount of epiphanies I have. How often am I having epiphanies? When was the last one I had? And the most recent major epiphany I had came to me in undergrad while I was maneuvering for comfortable sleeping in the back seat of my Honda underneath a leather jacket, right? I was homeless. I was poor. My grades were in the toilet. I had no friends. And for the first time in my life, I had no idea what was next for me. And then one day, it hit me. And this changed the trajectory of my life from that moment forward. None of this matters. The money, possessions, grades, looks, weight, popularity for the most part, it doesn't matter. All of the man-made constructs that we attach our sanity to, they disappear. But when you help people, when you work to bring health and happiness to people, when you work to inspire others, to shift the social consciousness of everyone in a positive direction, you will be remembered. That's how you tattoo the world. That's how you leave your mark. And it's the only kind of power that really exists. It's the only kind of power that matters. So I want to say to you, if you ever find yourself forgetting where the power of the movement is, if you forget that there is a such thing as a movement, I want you to hear my voice when you peel yourself out of bed in the morning. I want it to echo when you're shuffling across the floor to go brush your teeth, to put your tie on, or to pull your dress up. I want you to remember this. If you start to feel like the forgotten star or the neglected star that's not getting that credit, if you start to doubt the power of the movement, remember, you're not just a star. You're a part of the entire universe, and you are powerful. So when you start to think that way, when you start to feel that way, and you ask yourself, where is the power of the movement, I want you to stop, and I want you to look in the mirror. Thank you, guys.
Epiphany that I can't follow Kyrie Smith. Oh, Lord. That is the power of the movement, people. Let's hear it for Kyrie Smith. And for all the young leaders here. Oh my goodness. So I have I've quintupled my speech here. I get to close out with giving you guys prizes, which everybody loves. So I must announce that there are some complimentary hotel nights coming to a few of you. If you hear your name, go to the meeting services counter at registration. Are you ready? Eugene Farrell, you get a hotel night. Elton Horton, are you there? Diane Hurley, you're a winner. Lisa Jones, Alex Mitchell, Karuna Ramachandran, I got that close, and Kirio Wallaby, you're all winning hotel nights here. Congratulations. I hope you're feeling as excited and inspired as I am standing up here. We have an incredible week of training. We're going to send you out on Thursday. We want you to come back together and join us for a dialogue that's going to be led by Karima Abdullah. But please just make the most of your week. Thank each other and respect each other and be proud. This is an important movement. You are the power of the movement. Just make this week the best you can possibly make it. And thank you. Thank you for all the work that you do in the communities. CADCA loves you. We're behind you 100%. Have a great week. Thank you very much.